What is herpes? Herpes is an infection caused by HSV, or the herpes simplex virus. The herpes simplex virus, or herpes, is categorized into two types: herpes simplex virus type 1, otherwise known as HSV1, or oral herpes, sometimes commonly known as a cold sore, or 2, herpes simplex virus type 2, HSV2, otherwise known as genital herpes. Let's take a closer look at herpes simplex virus type 1, known as oral herpes. We know that it's a highly contagious infection, which is common and endemic throughout the world. Most HSV1 infections are acquired during childhood, and infection is lifelong. Majority of the HSV1 infections are oral herpes, and they're infections that are around the mouth, known as oral labial, or oral facial herpes. Let's talk about the incidence of HSV1, known as oral herpes. In 2012, an estimated 3.7 billion people under the age of 50, or 67% of the population, had HSV1 infection. Estimated prevalence of the infection was highest in Africa, there were 87%, and the lowest in the Americas, which ranged between 40 and 50%. 140 million people aged 15 to 49 years were estimated to have genital HSV1 infection worldwide in 2012, but prevalence varied substantially by region. Most genital HSV1 infections are estimated to occur in the Americas, Europe, and Western Pacific, where HSV1 continues to be acquired well into adulthood. In other regions, for example in Africa, most HSV1 infections are acquired in childhood before the age of sexual debut. Now let's take a look at herpes simplex virus type 1, oral herpes, and how it's transmitted. Oral-to-oral contact, which is the main transmission of the virus in sores, saliva, and surfaces around the mouth. Oral to genital contact, which may cause genital herpes. HSV1 can be transmitted from oral or skin surfaces that appear normal and when there are no symptoms present. The greatest risk of transmission is when there are active sores. Individuals who already have HSV1 oral herpes infection are unlikely to be subsequently infected with HSV1 in the genital area. In rare circumstances, HSV1 infection can be transmitted from a mother with genital HSV1 infection to her infant during delivery. In looking at the incubation period, it normally lasts between 2 to 12 days. Its signs and symptoms may include nothing at all, which is mostly asymptomatic, or tingling, itching, or burning sensation around the mouth before the appearance of sores. Painful blisters or open sores called ulcers in or around the mouth, known as cold sores. Clusters or groups of painful blisters, also termed fever blisters, or vesicles erupt or ooze with a clear to yellowish fluid that may develop into a yellowish crust. Frequency of recurrences varies from person to person. When looking at oral sores, we may want to pay special attention to the fact that they cause intense pain occurring at the onset and makes eating and drinking difficult. It may occur on the lips, the gums, the front of the tongue, the inside of the cheeks, the throat, and the roof of the mouth. They may also extend down the chin and neck. Gums may become mildly swollen and red and may bleed. Neck lymph nodes often swell and become painful. In people in their teens and 20s, herpes may cause a painful throat with shallow ulcers and a grayish coating on the tonsils. It's important to remember that there's a period of communicability. Secretion of virus in the saliva may occur for up to 7 weeks after recovery from stomatitis. Patients with primary genital lesions are infectious for 7 to 10 days. Now let's look at herpes simplex virus type 2, otherwise known as genital herpes. It's widespread throughout the world and is almost exclusively sexually transmitted, causing genital herpes. HSV2 is the main cause of genital herpes, which can also be caused by herpes simplex virus type 1. Infection with HSV2 is lifelong and incurable. let's take a look at the incidence of HSV2, or genital herpes. Annually, 776,000 people in the United States get new herpes infections. Nationwide, 15.7% of persons aged 14 to 49 years have HSV2 infection. HSV2 infection is more common among women than among men, 20.3% versus 10.6% in 14 to 49 year olds. Possibly because genital infection is more easily transmitted from men to women than from women to men during penile vaginal sex. So how is herpes simplex virus type 2 transmitted? Primarily sexually. HSV2 is mainly transmitted during sex through contact with genital surfaces, skin, sores, or fluids of someone infected with the virus. HSV2 can be transmitted from skin in the genital or anal area that looks normal and is often transmitted in the absence of symptoms. In rare circumstances, HSV2 infection can be transmitted from a mother to her infant during delivery. Let's talk about the incubation period, which normally ranges between 2 and 12 days. The signs and symptoms include asymptomatic, which means no symptoms at all, or they could have a very mild symptom that goes unnoticed or is mistaken for another skin condition. There can be one or more vesicles or small blisters on or around the genitals, rectum, or the mouth. On its first outbreak, it usually has longer duration of herpetic lesions. It has increased viral shedding, making the HSV transmission much more likely. It has systemic symptoms, which include fever, body aches, swollen lymph nodes, or a headache. And the recurrence of the outbreaks are usually localized by genital pain, tingling or shooting pains in the legs, hips, or buttocks, which occur hours to days before the eruption of herpetic lesions, and are typically shorter in duration and are less severe than the first outbreak of genital herpes. Now let's talk about the diagnosis of herpes simplex virus. First, HSV1, or oral herpes. First, by immunosorbent assay, ELISA. This type-specific HSV1 blood test looks for antibodies to the HSV1 virus in the bloodstream. This test is highly sensitive and will only detect the presence of HSV1 antibodies. For HSV2, or genital herpes, a polymerase chain reaction, which is a more sensitive test, allows for more rapid and accurate results and is increasingly being used. They can also use a viral culture, which requires collection of a sample from the lesion, and once viral growth is seen, specific cell staining to differentiate between HSV1 and HSV2. The CDC does not recommend screening for HSV1 or HSV2 in the general population. Several scenarios where type-specific serologic HSV tests may be useful include patients with recurrent genital symptoms or atypical symptoms and negative HSV PCR or culture, patients with a clinical diagnosis of genital herpes but no laboratory confirmation, patients who report having a partner with genital herpes, patients presenting for an STD evaluation, especially those with multiple sex partners, persons with HIV infection, and MSM at increased risk for HIV acquisition. Now let's talk about the treatment for herpes simplex virus. Currently, there are no cures for herpes. Antiviral medications can, however, prevent or shorten outbreaks during the period of time that the person takes the medication. Daily suppressive therapy, for example, daily use of the antiviral medication for herpes, can reduce the likelihood of transmission to partners. There is currently no commercially available vaccine that is protective against genital herpes infection. It is important to talk about prevention. Avoid oral contact with others and sharing objects that have contact with saliva. Abstain from oral sex to avoid transmitting herpes to the genitals of a sexual partner. When talking about HSV2 or genital herpes, it's important to remember to abstain from sexual contact, and it's good to be in a long-term, mutually monogamous relationship with a partner who has been tested for STDs and is known to be uninfected.